IVM.
Please note, this episode was recorded in a public space with background noise, so the audio quality is not up to our usual standards. We apologize for any inconvenience. Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to All Things Policy. I'm Anirudh, a researcher with the Takshashila Institution's Geostrategy Program. I'm joined today by Pooja Haldea, who is an advisor at the Center for Social and Behavioural Change at Ashoka University. So just imagine that you have got yourself a banging new app from the Google Play Store, right? So it's absolutely fascinating. It's got all the bells and whistles. All it needs is a few pesky permissions. I'm pretty sure that you're willing to click the allow button on your Android phone right now, aren't you? But imagine you get a notification that says, no, this app has a one-star privacy rating. Would you still be tempted to install the app? I don't think you would, but Ms. Haldea here is the real expert. Without any further ado, I'm joined today by Rohan, my colleague with the technology policy vertical, and we're going to get into a discussion about how you change the normative behavior that people have about data privacy. Ms. Haldea, please tell us a little bit about how you guys came up with the idea that a rating for privacy could potentially be a nudge for people.
So I think it comes from a lot of literature on privacy, which talks about the privacy paradox, which is that when you ask people, they say that they care a lot about their privacy, their data. But then when you look at their actual behaviors, you don't see that match. And so that's famously called the privacy paradox. And it essentially, you know, comes back to saying people have an intent to protect their data, protect their privacy, but the actions that they take are not in line, so to speak. There's an intent to action gap. And this intent to action gap is actually a big area of study in the field of behavior science, which pretty much came from looking at this intent to action gap in everyday life. I talked about some, which was you want to eat healthy, but you still succumb to that dessert at the end of the meal. You want to exercise, but you can't get yourself to the gym. You want to save, but you're unable to do it. So all of these are, you know, examples of where there is a gap between intent to action and privacy, actually, as a topic. You see that gap in everyday behavior. So therefore, at our center, the Center for Social and Behavior Change, which is a part of Ashoka University, we look at such problems where there is a gap between intent to action, and then think about what biases are at play, what is preventing people from acting on things that they intend to do, and then what can we do, how can we nudge them to behave differently. When we looked at the whole privacy space, one of the things which came is that the decisions that people have to take when it comes to privacy are very complex. People don't have that kind of cognitive bandwidth to take into account all the potential uncertain future harms. And in those kind of situations where, you know, the cognitive load is too much, things like standardized labels, things like star ratings can work brilliantly. I mean, Amazon has already shown us that, you know, they list thousands and thousands of products, but it's still very easy for you and me to sort through it. And one of the ways we do it is through the star rating. We depend there in the wisdom of the crowd, so to speak, and we go ahead with whatever is highly rated. Zomato does it. There are so many websites which use this. And so we thought, why not also try something like that for a complex decision, you know, that privacy is.
So can you tell us a little bit about how this actually worked in an experimental context, if that's okay?
Yeah.
How did you do this setup? What is your sample size? How did you figure out that this is a nudge that could potentially work?
So first, let me caveat it by saying that we are still in the starting phase of actually testing some of this in India. A lot of the theory and literature that I was talking to you about is actually work which has been done globally. And in fact, one of the aim of the center is to produce India-specific, you know, sort of literature on this topic. You know, having said that, how did we arrive at this nudge? I mean, we basically looked at all the biases which are at play. So, for example, you know, we talk about the present bias, which is that, you know, you're going to get immediate gratification if you press OK on that app. But the harms to it are going to be long term. So we don't value, you know, we value something which we get immediately way more than anything in the future. So one, you know, that is one bias at play. There are other biases at play where, you know, we, because it is such a complex decision to play, anchoring effects play a lot of role, which is, anchoring effect basically means that, you know, whatever piece of information you get at right at the beginning, for some reason you anchor all your subsequent decisions on that piece. Sometimes that piece of information may be absolutely relevant. So an example would be that if you have surveys in which, you know, people are asked increasingly intrusive questions versus just another survey where the order is changed and people are asked questions in the order of decreasing sensitivity, people will disclose way more in cases where you start with the most private question. So again, we looked at all these biases, which we know play in privacy decision making, and then looking at literature came up with the kind of, nudges which typically work when such biases are at play. Now, we have the advantage of being a part of an educational institution, so we can marry the academic world with then looking at, you know, what is actually possible in terms of regulation, what's possible in the field, and hence come up with nudges which both have very sound academic literature to support it, but also are not so naive or so unscalable that, you know, will have no real world value. So the star rating is one such. Now, how are we going about doing this? So what we have done in our previous studies as well is we have what we call a mobile lab. It's literally a bus which we have refitted with computers. This bus can travel anywhere, and a lot of our lab experiments, instead of bringing people to a place, we actually go to them. And sometimes it's because, you know, a lot of the segments that we actually do these, get into our labs are people with low mobility. For example, let's say pregnant women. I mean, they cannot transport themselves to Ashoka University, for example, for a lab. So we actually go and take these labs to them. We decide the number of the sample size based on obviously the number of treatment arms that we have in any experiment. And that's the way that we are planning to run these experiments as well, with the use of our mobile lab, looking at more low to mid-income groups, and taking the lab to areas where we can recruit them and then take them through these experiments in a more controlled condition. The plan after that is, once it's been done in the lab, is then to take it to the field. So maybe even partner with real businesses and see how these nudges work out in the field, not just in the lab environment.
It's very interesting to see this panning out in like such a distinctly unique Indian context, right? Because I think Dan Ariely, who is one of the biggest names in behavioral science today, is quite open about the fact that a lot of his initial studies were based on a sample size of mostly Ivy League students.
Yes.
Right. So have you noticed that even though the global literature was based on Ivy League students, is there a substantial difference in the way that Indian norms, Indian cultural values impact the way that Indians go about these things?
Yes, and I think that's a million-dollar question. Unfortunately, there isn't that much literature available today for us to be able to say this across, you know, the different pieces of interventions, etc., that have worked globally. In fact, one of the mandates for the center is to look at what has worked globally and then replicate that in Indian context and see whether it holds true. We know something's true in general for low-income population. When there is scarcity, people are willing to take even less cognitive load. So in times of any kind of scarcity, whether it's, you know, hunger, whether it's scarcity of money, people end up being subject to biases and taking, you know, shortcuts and using heuristics even more. So there is work which has been done in different settings to show that. There isn't as much work been done in India to show how it, you know, how all of the, for example, famous Dan Ariely experiments pan out in India. But we are already seeing this in the work that we are doing, for example, in anemia, for example, the work that we are doing in family planning, that norms, societal norms play such a huge role, especially in cultures which are so collectivist versus a lot of the Ivy League students, the cultures they come from, that we are already seeing that those norms and play much bigger role than even individual biases.
So one of the most fascinating bits about your talk was the concept of valuing privacy.
Yes.
As when you sell it or
yes,
when it's in doubt to you. And I know that Ashoka is doing a lot of fascinating work on this subject, but I just wanted to elaborate on this a bit more, because
Yeah, so, often when we, look at the privacy paradox, people say, okay, if, people don't behave in manners which are protecting their privacy, they must not care for it. So then there is a lot of work which gets done on, okay, can we actually put a dollar value to how much people care about privacy? And typically, in economics or in any kind of experimental method to calculate the measure that people use is willingness to pay. So how much are you willing to pay for something is a good proxy for, the value you place on it. Now, what we see in privacy is that that measure kind of breaks down a little bit because of what I've referred to as the super endowment effect. So endowment effect basically says something very simply that, once you own something, immediately you place more value to it. So let's say I gave you a mug and now you own it. And now if I tell you to sell it to me, you are likely to quote 2x the amount than what you would have been initially willing to pay if I was offering that cup to you. So that's the endowment effect. 2x is typically what we see. People value things twice as much. In privacy, we see it actually goes up to 16x. So there are cases, experiments which have shown that people, are willing to pay, let's say they're willing to pay X to provide, to protect their data. They actually want 16x to give that same piece of data away. So that makes it very interesting where, the value, the willingness to pay is very different from willingness to accept. And these two measures should not be so different when they are so different. It's very tricky. Should I use willingness to pay as a measure or should I be using willingness to accept as a measure? And therefore, a lot of experiments about privacy, the results are, most scholars would say, take it with a pinch of salt because we are not even really clear on which of these measures actually make sense. So that's the super endowment effect, which works when it comes to our own data, that we want to pay very little to protect it, but we want a lot of money to share it. And that's a very interesting phenomenon.
So have you been working on nudges in context in mobile apps? Because Android Q just came out recently. And one of the big things about this is that privacy is a big feature in this. And it's going to keep telling you that this app's using a location in the background at all time. So I found it quite fascinating that my SMS app had my location on at all times. And that to me was just a minor nudge to just look at why does my messaging need
location.
So do you work around this and what this means?
So in fact, the why we actually partnered with the Busara Center for Behavioral Economics on this is because they actually have run such experiments in Kenya and other African countries where they have created real life apps. And they have actually seen people's behavior on apps which differ based on different privacy policies. So this goes back to one of the questions our research is trying to answer is that, what are the business benefits to better privacy features? Why should businesses be motivated? And so it's taking real life apps and offering real life services to be able to show that, businesses which disclose better, which actually disclose information in a more vivid fashion. Which actually end up sharing less data with third parties, which give you sometimes greater control. Those businesses, people have genuine preference for buying those businesses, using those businesses. And so in India also, we are planning to replicate very similar work by creating sort of real life. Now, whether it's going to be an app, currently we're more thinking that we'll create a real life service that is available to people who can access on online and then see, their willingness to take on that service or disclose information based on different privacy features.
Also, I recently found out that my Bose headphones have a privacy policy attached to them.
Yes.
As to the new Sony headphones that have come out. And because they capture what songs you're listening to, where you are.
Yes.
None of this data. And I just wanted to get your opinion on what all these new products that sort of bear the mark of surveillance capitalism, like,
yes,
where are we going with this? And to what extent is privacy terminally ill?
It's a big question. I don't know whether privacy is terminally ill or not. I think it would be quite wrong for us to. And in fact, this is one of the things also which plays in privacy because the challenges are so humongous. We kind of exhibit the ostrich effect where we just want to actually bury our head in the sand and just stop thinking about it. And when even your headphones sort of start recording data about you, a lot of people end up feeling that actually the game is lost. I mean, where and how much can I actually stop this from happening? I think it would be a disservice to leave it to an individual to decide, their privacy features. It would be a disservice to individuals to be able to actually monitor each interaction that they have with every device, in their lives. But that's where I think the imperative is on regulators more than anything else, on coming up with the policies which are not trying to thwart the gains which come from better customization, for example, but still limits, limits the use to which your data is going to be put to. And one of the golden rules I know a lot of people have talked about, even in regulation, is that your data should actually eventually only be used for things you expect it to be used for. I mean, that is in general a good rule. If your app is hearing your songs, you do expect that it will record it will know my preferences in music. But you don't want now this data being shared with some other third party, which may end up, using it to sell you some other products, or maybe sometimes even use your preferences correlated with some other preferences and form some sort of segmentation around you and then start hounding you with other services. So I don't think it's terminally ill, but I also think that it is too much to expect an individual to have control over it.
One of the major challenges today is that people don't know what their privacy is worth and they don't know how to conceptualize it in their heads.
Yes.
And so I want to know if there are equally pressing questions apart from the conceptualization angle in people's heads that behavioral economics and centers like Busara and Ashoka are looking at. Like, apart from how to conceptualize privacy, like biases, what are the things that...
See, I think, as you've rightly said, that the trade-offs that are involved in sharing data or not sharing data, it's very hard to conceptualize. So there is obviously a lot of work that needs to go in how to make that easy. So, for example, either making the understanding of harms better or having greater clarity on, the trade-offs that you're making. Other than that, I've already spoken about, there is a bunch of work which should get done on even simple things like designing and presentation of consent forms, for example, so informed consent. And I talked about, whether it's by giving more information, which is actually user-friendly, which is about, presenting in a way that is more understandable. Whether it's, by the way, which I also talked about, is the use of defaults, whether making sure that, because defaults are known to be effective. Whatever is your default setting is likely to remain the setting. So how can we, regulate those default settings a bit better? So there are, the presentation information. And then, of course, there is a whole area of incentives that we also want to work on, which is how can we create not just financial but social incentives or disincentives for companies or for websites or for apps which behave one way or the other. Similarly, how can we create incentives and disincentives for people to be more informed, in the consent that they are giving? So these are some of the other questions and some of the other sort of areas that we are looking at as a center.
So, wow, thank you so much for joining us, Ms. Haldea. I personally learned quite a lot about behavioral science. It's so interesting to see that we have Indians who are working to really conceptualize this really powerful discipline to something that could make Indian lives better. So, thank you for attending. Thank you guys for listening to All Things Policy. And we'll catch you in our next episode.
Thank you.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com. or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVMPodcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle @TakshashilaInst or our website takshashila.org.in.
How many times have you caught yourself googling stuff on health and wondering if it's the right information? How many times have you heard different health experts give opposing views, which has only left you confused? There are rising cases of cancer, heart, diabetes, stress, and autoimmune diseases. Meet the patients and the experts who paved the path of true healing. Join me, Rachna Chachi, cancer nutrition coach and nutritional therapist on Heal and Hearty. I take you through my own journey of recovery from an incurable disease and the journey of so many others who healed only via nutrition and holistic healing. Find the answers you seek for what's good for your health and what's good for your soul. You can listen to us on the IBM Podcast app or ibmpodcast.com. Don't forget your date with good health.
Advertising is dead. Yep, you heard me right. Advertising is dead. We're all in the content business now. Let's not call it news, TV, radio, etc., etc. It's all content, and we're in the middle of this weirdly exciting phase where all the borders and lines that have been drawn over decades has been swept away by this lovely thing called the internet. We're a show where we don't dwell on just the stuff that is now, but rather the wider stuff about advertising, media, content, and the whole goddamn circus surrounding it. Tune in every Tuesday for our weekly unboxing of the mystery box we used to call advertising. I'm Varun Dugirala, co-founder and content chief at The Glitch, and this is my new podcast, Advertising is Dead.